we all know the usual thing about tying up cables if you're making up looms and things like that. You'll use cable ties. But I've used thousands of these in my career. Problem is, you need different lengths for a start. Yeah, you can have long ones like this or little tiny short ones. But for each different size of cable form that I'm doing, you need one of each. Problem is when you tie a cable or cable form, you use whatever you've got to hand, and it will cut off the end. Well, obviously, you know, this is a bit on the large side, but you know, you get a bit of waste with it, and when you do a few thousand cable ties, there's a lot of plastic waste. The other thing is, this one's not quite so bad, but the end of that can become sharp, and it's not very nice to touch. Also, I think in some ways it looks a bit unsightly. There was a job I was doing where we did about 2 kilometres of overhead cabling. We put a steel wire as a strainer, and then we attached the cable to it using cable ties. A few months down the line, a lot of the cable ties come undone. What happened is they'd hardened in the sun and basically split, so we had to go back and do the job again. So I'm going to show you something a bit different, something that I used to do it in telecoms. I used to install telephone exchanges, and we ran thousands and thousands of meters of cable around that place. So this is just a ball of string I bought locally, but if you look on the net, you can find what they call lacing twine, and what you want is the wax covered cotton type stuff. Don't go for the nylon. I haven't actually used the nylon one. I've seen they call wax finish or something. I'm not sure if that's actually got wax in it, but the waxed lacing twine is actually impregnated with wax, and it's very strong. And I noticed when I was doing the setup for the demonstration, this stuff, yeah, it hasn't got very good tensile strength, so I did actually break it with my hand. So yeah, wax lacing twine. It's not very expensive. You get quite a large roll with it, and it lasts a long time. Advantage is you only need one size. There's actually, I think, 3 sizes that I've seen on the net. Once you pick your size, then yeah, you can do cable forms, you know, really big down to something really tiny, all with the same piece of string or lacing twine. And I'll show you first of all what we did to start. This one is I can't remember, they call it a clove hitch or half hitch or something. You could use any knot, it doesn't really matter, but this is the one that I was taught. And that's the sort of thing you want to aim for. You can see that. And that then tightens up on the cable. The basic lacing knot is just a knot. I'll just cut this string off. And all you do is pass it under the cable, through the loop. And it is just a knot, as you can see there, hopefully. And you can manipulate this so that you get your spacings if you want to have some nice neat spacings. So yeah, in a few seconds I've done that, and apart from the start and finish, there's no cutting off of ends or anything like that. You can form harnesses where you take wires off of the form and come out through. In fact, I'll show you one that I've prepared earlier. As you see, it's just a demonstration. I've just started off at one end, started lacing through. Get a bit more light on that. Done a few knots, and then I've split out the side with another form all the way along. And on this one, I've actually come out and I've started to do more splitting. Good thing about these tail ends, you can actually use them to secure the harness somewhere that is fixed fairly tight, then your main form will stay in place. But obviously normally you'd cut these ends off. To do the side, as you're tying along, if you want to bring one out here, then it's just a case of laying a cord in when you bring your cable off, so it's ready, and you can tie that in with the original form. And what we normally do is, in fact, we actually go back one, so that's where your form will come out, just there. Your string is in line with it, and then when you do this next one, you're actually going back on yourself. So that the new bit of cable coming out between the two knots, and that secures that piece in place. So that's your side harness as such, and then you continue on main tying. So there's your side piece, and then you can use this side piece then to lace your harness coming this way. The tail of that, you just lay it in with the cable, and then as you knot in the side piece, then that will disappear in the form and give you a reasonably solid makeup then. So notice on this one, there's a double knots, there's your side string, and the cable comes out between the two. But that's not on between the two, that's on the end of it. But you get the idea. You do it the way you feel you're comfortable with, and yeah, it all goes quite well. One problem with cable ties is when you want to fix this down to something. In the telephone exchanges I worked in, we had what was called a ladder rack, or a grid mesh. Now the grid mesh is a bit like a, I don't know if you've seen the reinforcing mesh that they use for concrete bases, sort of 3 or 4 inch square sections, yeah, made out of bars. And if you want to tie this down, the cable tie sits at an angle on your bar. If you're tying it down like that, then your cable tie will go from corner to corner. The alternative is to put a cable tie underneath, or use special cable ties with a screw hole in it, and tie it that way. Not very nice. You can still use string to do cable ties on ladder racking, or crossbars like this. And I'll just show you that. So this is basic makeup. I've done two already. What you'll notice is it's done as a stack. There's nine cables there, and they're in a square stack. There's two ways of doing this. One is as you do each layer. The other one is once you've got your stack in position, you do other lacing. Now what I would recommend when you're doing this sort of lacing is you make up a tool. Now this is what is known as a lacing needle. We actually had professionally made ones of these, but this is an old hacksaw blade, and you want one that's flexible, that's not going to snap easily on you. Some of them are quite brittle, and you've got to be careful when you're using those. They snap on you when you're trying to push a piece of string through the form, as you'll see in a minute. The blade snaps and you can hurt yourself. But all you need to do is, on one end, where your normal mounting hole is for your hacksaw, just cut a slot into there at an angle, so you make a hook. And the other end is actually a V cut in the end. Probably just might pick that up. The V is for pushing, the hook is for pulling. The other thing you want to do is run it on the grinder and take off any sharp edges, including the sides, because the hacksaw blade's got a wavy profile to it. Make it so it's completely blunt, it's not going to cut your cables. And there's your lacing needle. Now, the lacing needle is used once you've formed your basic band around, is you can put it through the form, put your string onto it and pull it through. And then if you want to poke it through the other side, put it into the V and you can push it through. Very useful if you're working from one side and you can't get your needle in the other side. So I'm going to show you first of all the layering technique, where you start off with your individual wires. And what we used to do was get a piece of cardboard and just wrap a few turns of twine around it, enough to do the job if possible. Some length, some run length when you're doing linear lacing, you have quite a lot, so you have to just do a certain amount and then join it. That's done by just a simple knot. When you start off, you always find it best to tie all the strings on the ladder rack to start with before the cable actually gets run in. And it's exactly the same starting knot hitch, and you can run the tail underneath the form so it's out of the way if you want to. And all that is basically the same thing. Tie your lacing knot and get it to bed down in there. Well, that cable's now secure. So then you can bring in your next cable, and you notice that tail end I tucked under the first cable and cut that off to tidy it up. Third one. This method tends to put gaps between. If you can get your knots to sit right down tight, as I say, this string isn't the right stuff. The lacing twine is normally a lot thinner than this. And then you bring in your next layer. Now this is where you don't really want it on the cardboard. Also where the lacing needle comes in handy, because then you can push your string through underneath this. Is not ideal because it's not supported, but then you can also use your needle to pull up the other side. Basically, you continue all the way back, and then once you've finished getting your pile in place, you can actually do the cross piece, which I'll show you on the other method. So that's pretty straightforward. Just go by your layers, lay your wires in as you want, and make up your stack. The other method, and what you want to do, head of where you're working, just do a basic tie down. Just to hold them in place so they don't shift around on you. Normally these would be like long runs that we'd do in the type of exchanges. And then this is why you normally tie your strings on first, because lot easier to do without the cables in a way. You've got your starting knotting position. Again, as the tail end, I'll tuck that underneath the cable so it's out of the way. Cut off the end. And this time, I'm going to do the basic lacing knot again. Pull them reasonably tight. You don't need to do them too tight because that causes problems later. Just to bundle them up. And then form them into your 3x3 block. Adjust your knot as required. So it sits close to both sides like that. This is where your lacing needle comes in. And if you go up to layer 2, you push a string or pull it all the way through to the other side. Back in the other side and pull it back, and what that's done is put a loop around the second layer there, so when you pull it again, don't pull it too tight, just do it enough to tension it up. And this is where it gets a little bit involved. It's always best to use the end of the string to do pulling and pushing. That way you fray the end of the string and not the middle of the string. You push it through, back through that second layer, and then you use your hook to pull it up, and then into the next layer. What you've done is switched layers in the middle of the form, so you've gone from the first layer into above the first layer to above the second layer and pulled out the other side. And so you always try and use the end of the string as you pull through. Now we've got the second one in there. You see the first layer loop and the second layer loop. Again, pull that to your required tension. Again, in through your first layer, sorry, in through your second layer, and bring it up to the top. And that's all I did on that previous layer, except I come out through the side. So that's all you're doing. You're just moving it up a layer. Bit of tension on there just to pull it in. And now we do exactly the same, but going up and down. So now I go down through the bottom. Pull it back up the same line. Now you've got to change columns. And It's just a matter of pushing it across. And pulling out the next one. And this is why I say don't use nylon, because nylon tends to cut if you rub it across the cable like that. You want it to be fairly soft, but it ought to be as thin as you want it, and so waxed. Push it down the next one. Back up. And now we decide where we want to tie it off. You can basically tie it off anywhere. I think I'll tie it off back on the main bar. So what you can do, remember that's come up from the bottom there, through that one. Going back down the same hole, what I'm going to do is pull it back on one of those and then push it down. So basically that's come up through one hole and then back down again, but underneath the next layer. And then it's just a simple matter of get rid of the end. You can actually cut a bit more of the end off and tuck that into the form so it doesn't show, and it also locks the end. What you see there is a nice square solid form, and you can see, as I pointed out earlier, the loops on this side are nice and tight coming through the other side. You've got the same sort of loops on the top, and the bottom is held onto the crossbar. So that's not going to move anywhere, that'll stay there as long as you want. And the waxing on the string does two things. When you're putting it through, making knots, it lubricates the sliding effect, and you can actually pull it through a lot easier. But once you've finished tightening up your knot, the wax will obviously set and hold it all together. So that's your inline lacing. You could do your inline lacing, and you could actually then do an attachment to your crossbars if you wanted to do it that way. Or for larger cables, you can just do the attachment that way, either by layering or by doing a complete bundle of the box. Doesn't say you can't do, just get a bundle together like I've done on the end here, just form a neat bundle and just tie a knot over it. It doesn't make much difference, but this is the way that I was taught at the Turbo Exchange how to do it, and I think it's a lot neater, and you can run your hands over that and it's not going to catch your hands with these nasty nylon ties. And it's, once you get used to it, it's actually quite quick to do, and as I'm going to show you in a moment. Okay, what you can see here is a setup where I've got a piece of extra wire. There's the main run running through. That could be a cable form, not just a single wire. Then this is representing a wire that comes in and goes out. I've got my starting knot there already. So just ordinary inline lacing. That end you can incorporate into the loom like that, tidy it up or whatever, move around the side, get out of sight. And you can adjust your positions. A bit of practice does that. Now, this is just a temporary tie in the position where the cable comes out, just to hold it in place. And what we were always taught is tie round after where the cable enters. You move your temporary knot out of the way. Then you can wrap your knot, sorry, your extra string round the side like that. When you go back on yourself, that locks that string into place, which will eventually go around there. And you continue to lace. What I find always useful is if you bring the loop out like that, it means you can adjust that loop to where you want it. Even put your thumb in position to hold it in place. Remove that temporary knot. Just continue on like that. As I said before, where you branch out, go in after the branch, add in your string, and remove that temporary knot. That's just a simple hitch that you can just easily undo. There's your knot after the branch. Oops, entangled up here. Then you go before the branch. And that locks it all into place. And then just continue on. That's how easy it is. These side strings, then obviously your tail, when you start tying them in or start lacing down your tails, you can incorporate the other string somewhere in there to hide it away. So it should look something like that. Yeah, on that one. Yeah, very easy. Obviously you can bring in other ones at the same point as you come out from, so there's no going back over that to cut off loose ends apart from the actual three ends. So there you go, that's the art of inline lacing to make up cable forms, etc. Very simple to do, it's just a basic knot. Yeah, obviously follow the guidelines, but you know, create your own knots, whatever you want to do, whatever's easiest for you. Also show you the other about ladder rack, or attaching it to some sort of cross member. And don't forget, if you're doing the box method, then you'll want the lacing needle, which I showed you earlier in the video, and you know, hook on one end and a V groove on the other end, pushing through. There are other methods of making up this sort of cable form, and that's something like what they call spy wrap. It's a spiral of plastic. That's time consuming and I think expensive as well. It's not something I would normally buy, I just happen to have this laying around. But try not to use ordinary string like I did. This is just for demonstration purposes. As I said, look on the web, you'll see lacing twine, that's what it's called. And you want to look for the waxed lacing twine. It's normally made of cotton or natural materials. It's quite resilient. I say, we used to use it in telephone exchanges, and you know, they're still cables are still in place. I mean, how long ago was a telephone exchange built? You know, years and years ago, like I don't know, 100 years ago. And the string is still there. So there you go. I hope you found that entertaining and informative, and I see people starting to get away from the old cable ties and things like that, and get back into you know, a nice skill.